Dr. Balavan, we are now live and participants are joining in. We may wait for a few seconds so that a few more participants may join.
The number is increasing. So let us wait for maybe 30 more seconds. I think we can start now, Dr. Haldar, Shashank.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. We can start now.
Yeah. A very good morning, all. And welcome to this webinar on homeopathic approach in COVID-19 pandemic. And we all have been facing a very difficult situation for the last 1.5 years all over the world. And since the beginning of the pandemic, homeopathy and homeopaths have started helping people to prevent as well as to manage this condition, pandemic condition, COVID-19. And as the disease progressed, the pandemic progressed, many experts all over the world have started putting their records or giving their reports of their experiences, how COVID-19 can be handled and managed with homeopathy. And if you check CTRI, Clinical Trial Registry of India, there have been a good number of studies, trials registered in the CTRI. And if you check PubMed, yes, there have been many, many studies or reports or experiences recorded and reported in PubMed portal. And with that background, we keep on conducting webinars in this series, that how we the homeopaths have been managing the cases of COVID-19, whether it is in many cases it is a standalone and also it is as a supportive therapy. As per the government guidelines, it has to be a supportive therapy. But there are some patients who want to take only homeopathy in the beginning, maybe in the mild to moderate cases. And if as per a report, I think around 80 to 90% of cases are get relieved with standalone homeopathic therapy. And yes, if it goes to moderate to severe, then yes, the hospitalization may be required and the other standard treatment protocol may be required. And today we have Dr. Ubaid, who has a rich experience in handling COVID-19 pandemic cases. And he is assistant professor as well as head of cancer department of AM Sheikh Homeopathic Medical College, Belgavi. And also he is doing a private practice for a very long time. And with his experience, he has given his concern to present his experiences in this webinar, and I welcome him. And I welcome our sales and marketing team, starting from head office, Mr. Shashank, and also other colleagues, and also our team from Belgavi and South region, Mr. Mohan and Mr. Nawaz. Mr. Mohan will be joining shortly. I welcome them also. And we have been having a regular continuous technical support from Dr. Haldar from West Bengal. And thank you for your support, Dr. Haldar, and welcome you as well. And the participants who have been here with a zeal to learn more and more on COVID-19 pandemic, even though each and every one of you have your own experiences with this COVID-19 pandemic, but yes, this is how we learn from each other. Maybe what I have learned, maybe different from what Dr. Ubaid has learned. or somebody else has learned. So we learn from each other. So I welcome you all to this session. Now, Dr. Obaid, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay, then we will start. So today there is an interactive session on COVID-19, about homeopathic approach in COVID-19. This should not be a one-sided discussion. It should be interactive so that we can learn from each other. So we will start. Sir, please minimize this. Just a second. So as we all know that this corona is like common flu, which is difficult to differentiate and diagnose. Like all others, many recent homeopaths also trying to find preventive medicine for this corona disease, which Dr. Honeyman also faced in his time. But to find something like genus epidemicus or a specific remedy or some preventive medicine for this, first, we have to see whether we really following the true Honeymanian teachings and principles or not. So without specific guidelines, we cannot find genus epidemicus. First of all, we should give attention to the psoriatic symptoms which are listed in the theory of chronic disease, without which we cannot deal with the epidemics and also cannot find genus epidemicus or the so-called specific medicine or the preventive medicine. So to find a genus epidemicus, there are some inclusion and exclusion criteria given in the Honeymanian literature, in TCD and lesser writings, and also in Organon. So Dr. Honeyman, as we all know, genus epidemicus, everybody calls it as a genus epidemicus, but Dr. Honeyman never used that term as genus epidemicus. He used epidemic, pandemic, endemic, or specific homeopathic remedy for a particular disease or a particular endemic or epidemic. So if we understand how he found out and used a specific remedy for scarlet fever in 1799 epidemic, then we can understand how to find the remedy for this corona also. So actually, what is the problem with us is we know the science, but we don't know the philosophy behind it. We know homeopathy as a medical science, but we don't understand that philosophy which lead to the foundation of homeopathy and the homeopathy principles. We know homeopathy is a medical science, and we know some remedies, and we don't know how to prescribe them and when to prescribe them and what is the philosophy and logic behind the prescribing behind them. We don't know how Honeyman faced the problems, how he came to the conclusions, how he came to the addition of organons, because of which we are unable to face such difficult and incurable cases like corona in the last stage, or cancer cases, or renal failure because we don't know the philosophy and the literature what Hahnemann has written, because we follow the recent stalwarts who also not studied those literatures of the Organon or literature of the Hahnemann. So because of which we are unable to face the such difficult cases. If we understand thoroughly about the homeopathy from the literature of the Hahnemann, then we are able to handle the difficult cases like corona and all. Like corona, cancer and all. So today we will discuss about basic virology and basic immunology and pathogenesis of coronavirus in a nutshell. Role of antibiotics and antivirals and steroids, whether they're really helpful in the in this epidemic or not. In not only in this epidemic or any epidemic, or simple cold and corona, whether they are helpful or not. So Dr. Hahnemann's guidelines in epidemics. And we will also discuss about the role of diet and regimen, which is completely neglected nowadays, and which is very important to cure a case. And possible homeopathic remedies in COVID-19. And we will discuss cases in short. So the virology and immunology says coronaviruses are single stranded developed RNA viruses. They are RNA viruses, not DNA, that infect wide range of hosts, including humans, bats, and other mammals and birds. So remember, these coronaviruses are RNA viruses. So the coronaviruses are classified within the order of nidovirals and are further subclassified into four genera, alpha, beta, delta, and gamma, of which alpha and beta viruses are known to infect humans. Human coronaviruses are associated with lower pathogenicity, contributing to seasonal cases of common cold and sometimes linked to more severe respiratory illness. Coronaviruses have four major structural proteins, and amongst that, E protein is thought to be most critical for coronavirus infectivity. SARS-CoV-2 has genetic polymorphism in the S protein when compared to other coronaviruses that can cause lethal human diseases. So coronaviruses enter into the body through interacting with ACE2. ACE2 is a transmembrane protein on type 2 pneumocytes in the alveoli and intestinal epithelial cells and nasal goblet secretory cells. SARS-CoV-2 can enter the body by two pathways, either through endocytosis or through non-endocytosis cell surface entry. So the primary immune response in COVID-19 is such that there is increase in the neutrophils, increase in the monocytes and macrophages in the lungs, causing cytokine storm, which increase in level of serum pro-inflammatory cytokines. In COVID-19, increase in neutrophils in the lungs are associated with severe diseases. So the primary immune response in COVID-19 is such that there is increase. So the higher serum pro-inflammatory response is seen in people with COVID-19 are associated with severity of the disease, which suggests that a cytokine storm is involved in the pathogenesis of this corona disease. And the other characteristic features of this virus are the influenza virus works like this. Influenza virus works like works by destroying the protective membrane of the cell lining a person's airways, making them susceptible to pathogens present in the air that they breathe. This in turn leads to fatal lung infections. So the clinical presentation of COVID-19 is as follows. So the common symptoms of corona are cough, fever, fatigue, sputum, shortness of breath, myalgia, sore throat, headaches, nasal congestion and nausea, vomiting and diarrhea, which we are seeing nowadays in the second wave. So these are the common symptoms which are also found in the common flu-like diseases, flu-like fevers. So the elderly and those who with comorbid conditions, most clearly cardiovascular diseases, respiratory conditions and cancer are at higher risk for a more disease course and death. So the investigations which we do in this corona to find out whether it is COVID or not is RT-PCR test. Actually, it is what I think it is unreliable test, but still it is a marker. Lab findings are very important, like CBC, where we find the leukopenia and false positive of this typhoid and dengue also. When you come across a patient with fever and you see he will be diagnosed with typhoid positive or dengue, or there is a decreased platelet count, so you have to rule out this corona, because in corona this typhoid and dengue are coming as a false positive. Then the D-dimer test, then the ferritin and the CRP. Then the most reliable test was serological antibody test, chest findings like HRCT, where you find a typical glass ground opacities. Then the physical examination of SpO2, oxygen saturation, and the respiratory rate. So how to interpret whether it is a corona or not? So an increasing pattern of CBC, CRP, and D-dimer are suggestive of an ongoing cytokine storm. Stable or decreasing pattern of CBC, CRP, and D-dimer are suggestive of signs of improvement. The present results of the blood are to be compared with the previous results that have been taken on the day one. Then we will come to know whether it is deteriorating or whether it is getting cured. So there are three categories in this corona cases. So the category one, which is a low risk group, are the patients with no comorbid state, with mild fever, with respiratory rate less than 24, and the SpO2 around 95%. And there is second category patients with moderate risk group. Those are the patient with existing comorbidity like diabetes, hypertension, or some renal or cardiac or something, who have already some existing comorbidities. They come under the category two or moderate risk group, who has also having persisting fever, respiratory rate between 25 to 30, and SpO2 around 90 to 94. So these are moderate risk group peoples. And the category three are these are high risk group people, in which the patients with already existing comorbidities, who are having persistent fever and whose SpO2 or oxygen saturation is less than 90 and the respiratory rate becomes more than 30. So the general management of these cases is advise them to do 6 minutes walk test daily to check the exertional dyspnea, and then tell them to check temperature and SpO2 once in 4 hours, encourage them to do awake prone ventilation, then breathing exercise and warm drinks. So any confusion till now? So if you have any confusion, then please ask, then afterwards we will go to the approaches, how what is the allopathic approach in these of cases and what allopathy can do in these cases, not only in these cases, any other case. In simple cold and chorus also, what allopathy can do, we will discuss, and what homeopathy can do, what the diet and regimen can do. So am I going fast or is it okay? Okay. So we'll see the allopathic approach in these corona cases. So they have the treatment which targeting the treatment based on ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers, which attack and block the endocytic pathway. But this virus enters through either endocytic or non-endocytic pathway. But they have their remedies which block the endocytic pathway. But it can enter through non-endocytic also. But whenever you hear block, suppress, or something, what comes in your mind? Anybody heard about the allopathy medicine as curative medicine, any medicine like simple paracetamol, whether it is a curative or any antibiotic or any steroid? So anybody knows any drug of allopathy which is curative? So as per I know, chat box say, yeah, not most of the action is suppressive, all the action is suppressive only, Salman. So if you read the pharmacopoeia of allopathy, all medicines, from any molecule, if you take best of the best molecule, they write it is a good suppressive medicine. Not curative also, not palliative also, everything suppresses only. So when suppression comes into mind, when block ACE blockers, beta blockers, this block, that block, A block, O block, this suppression, that suppression, what comes to your mind? कोई अच्छी फीलिंग आती है क्या, ये वो सप्रेस कर रहा है मेरे पेशेंट को या मुझे बहुत अच्छा है ऐसा लगता है क्या, मुझे ब्लॉक कर रहा है बहुत अच्छा लगता है क्या? सो इट मीन्स दे आर सप्रेसिंग समथिंग विच वन डे विल इरप्ट लाइक एनीथिंग. सो हम लोग ये छोटे छोटे एंटीबायोटिक ये वो सब ये ले 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 के सप्रेस करते हैं और टाइम बींग हमको लगता है कि एलोपैथी बहुत अच्छा काम की, बहुत अच्छे से क्योर हुआ, ये हुआ और खुश होके घूमते हैं. बाद में एक तीन चार दिन जाता है जाती है, थोड़ा थोड़ा वापस चालू होता है. चालू होने के बाद फिर स्टोरी वहीं पे और इट विल बिकम मोर इनक्यूरेबल देन द बिफोर. पहले जाते हैं सर्दी खांसी से, उसको सप्रेस करके आते हैं. सप्रेस करने के बाद में एक्सपेक्टोरेशन चालू हो जाता है, तब सप्रेस करते हैं, मैं तीन दिन में ठीक हूँ, एंटीबायोटिक लेके ये लेके वो लेके ऐसा बोलते हैं. फिर दो तीन एक दो दिन ठीक लगते हैं, फिर चौथे दिन थोड़ा थोड़ा माइल्ड फीवर चालू है सर करके आते हैं, खांसी उसके साथ एक्सपेक्टोरेशन चालू आ रहता है, उसके साथ अंदर वीजिंग रैटलिंग ये अगर धीरे धीरे बोल के पूरा लंग की वाट लग जाती है ऐसा बोल के. बिकॉज ऑफ एलोपैथी ट्रीटमेंट ओनली पेशेंट बिकम माइल्ड टू मॉडरेट, मॉडरेट टू सीवियर, नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ द डिसीज. And most of the patient who died because in the COVID, in this corona pandemic, because of the allopathic medicine, not because of the corona. जितने भी मरे सब लोगों को 25 antibiotic, 25 steroid, ये सब उनको बस नहीं हुआ इसलिए immunomodulator, immunosuppressant, ये सब दे के नाक में इधर उधर एक एक पाइप डाल के उसकी हालत खराब करके, तो इंसान बचेगा क्या इतना सब करेंगे तो? उसको पहली तकलीफ में रहता और ये लोग इधर उधर उधर इधर टोच के और थोड़ा तकलीफ देते हैं. तो जितनी भी मरे हैं उसमें से 80% पूरे एलोपैथी मेडिसिन से मरे, बाकी जो मरे वो डर के मरे और गिने चुने जो मरे वो आजू बाजू वाले जो जो को ऑलरेडी कोमॉर्बिडिटीज वगैरह थे. So first of all, it is a viral disease, so there is no role of antibiotics that are being prescribed in COVID cases. And moreover, the antiviral that has been prescribed like remdesivir has also proved to be non-effective. Some have the ability to act on the cell limiting to its membrane only, but this is so-called coronavirus's capability to permeate the cell membrane and enter the nucleus of the cell, where no antibiotic or antiviral is capable to act. So as we all know, बीच में रेमडेसिविर बिकेम अ रामबान, सब जितना स्टॉक खत्म हुआ उतना दे दिए हम लोग. बाद में बोलते हैं कि रेमडेसिविर इज ऑफ नो यूज, और फर्स्ट वे में HCQ को बोला गया कि इट इज लाइक अ रामबान, और बाद में बोलते हैं कि वो भी काम नहीं करता है. एंड नाउ दे केम विद द DRDO. सो एक के बाद एक एक्सपेरिमेंट चल रहा है लेकिन कहीं पे भी पेशेंट का रिलीफ नहीं है. So what Hanneman says about this, what allopathy medicines or allopathy molecules or chemicals do in our body. So in aphorism number 74, Dr. Hanneman says that among chronic diseases, those that are produced artificially by allopathy treatment, by its prolonged use of violent heroic medicines in large and increasing doses, where the vital energy is weakened to an unmerciful extent, and sometimes it deranges in such a way that in order to maintain life against these inimical and destructive attacks, it must produce a revolution in the organism. So samajh mein hai ki what allopathy medicine can do in a human body. So when we give allopathy treatment, Dr. Hanneman says vital energy becomes weakened to an unmerciful extent, जिसके वजह से क्या होता है, टू मेंटेन लाइफ अगेंस्ट दीज एलोपैथी मेडिसिंस एंड डिस्ट्रक्टिव अटैक्स इट मस्ट प्रोड्यूस अ रेवोल्यूशन इन द ऑर्गेनिज्म टू सेव इटसेल्फ. तो अपने खुद को सेव करने के लिए क्या होता जाता है स्टेप बाय स्टेप, इफ वी रियलाइज व्हाट विल हैपन. So either it will deprive some of its part to survive, or exalt this to an excessive degree, or even total destruction of certain parts, or develop faulty organic alterations here and there to preserve the organism from total destruction of life. Then he further says in the same aphorism, no intelligent man can see anything medical or medicinally helpful in this allopathy treatment. Whereas real medicines, even if chosen blindly and administered blindly to a patient at times, proves beneficial to it because of its homeopathicity. So it is inappropriate and murderous to take away pounds of blood for blood investigation. They do know everyday blood investigation and this. So Dr. Honeyman says it is inappropriate and murderous to take away pounds of blood when few appropriate medicines would dispel this sick state, because such great loss of blood is impossible to manufacture by the weakened organ, though it can in the same quantity, but not of same quality as before. So जो blood investigation के लिए रोज 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 लेके वो क्या होता है, इससे इंसान की vitality और weak हो जाती है. बाद में वो प्रोड्यूस होता है, उतनी क्वांटिटी में प्रोड्यूस होता है, लेकिन वो क्वालिटी खराब हो जाती है उसकी ब्लड की. सो इट मीन्स यू शुड नॉट डू इन्वेस्टिगेशन साइंड अगेन एंड अगेन अगेन एंड अगेन अगेन एंड अगेन. सो एवरी सिक मैन लैक्स स्ट्रेंथ, अदरवाइज हिज वाइटल एनर्जी वुड प्रिवेंट द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ डिसीज. It is murderous malpractice, irrational and cruel, based on groundless and absurd theories. Instead of taking away his disease, which is dynamic in nature, and this can only be removed by the dynamic potentials and remedies. So the questions, whichever you need to ask, you can ask, and in the last I will, during case presentation, I will answer your questions that Dr. Abdul Rashid and all asked them about the person who aged 60 years and all. So anybody has any doubt, you can just send a message. And we will discuss in the later. In the end. So this is what Honeyman says about the allopathic treatment, what it can do in a human body. So now we will see what Dr. Honeyman says about epidemics. What are his guidelines? So we, the present homeopathic practitioners, are whether we are really following the true Honeymanian principles or not. To understand this, his guidelines, first, we should know whether we are really practicing or following the Honeymanian principles or guidelines or not. What does the literature written by Dr. Honeyman mention about epidemic fevers? Which aphorisms narrate about epidemic fevers? Instead of knowing the literature, just we follow if someone posts Aspidosperma is a life-saving drug. Once you come and camphor one name, can cure the corona. Jaise pata chala waise sab stocks khali ho gaye. Because we don't know the philosophy behind it, behind the epidemics and what Honeyman has written. So jab pata hi nahi chalega bole to aise sab comments se hum log follow hi karenge na. Koi bhi kuch bhi bata do, CPI ghar ke bahar chhidko bole to sab chhidak ke khatam hi. Dusre ko jisko zarurat hai usko mil hi nahi raha, aisa ho raha. So specific guidelines laid down by Dr. Honeyman with respect to finding preventive medicines, whom should we provide preventive medicine? Are there any specific exclusion and inclusion criteria? The importance of psoriatic symptoms in selecting a remedy in epidemic disease. So to find a preventive medicine, we have some inclusion and exclusion criteria also, and we should know to whom to give and whom not to give. This everything is written by Honeyman in his literature. ऐसा नहीं कि arsenic 30 पूरी दुनिया को चिपका दिया, ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए. To whom to give, first we have to understand, and how to find out the this preventive medicine or genus epidemicus, we have to understand from Honeyman, not through WhatsApp University or not through some media. तो तब पता चलेगा कि arsenic 30 सबको देना है या नहीं देना है, और arsenic 30 ये preventive है, जीनस एपिडेमिकस है या नहीं, ये हनीमन का पढ़ेंगे तो ही समझ में आएगा. नहीं बोले तो सबको फ्री में बांटेंगे और जिसको चाहिए पैसों से उसको भी नहीं मिलेगा, ऐसा होता है. सो इन लेसर राइटिंग्स डॉक्टर हनीमन, वी विल सी व्हाट डॉक्टर हनीमन सेज अबाउट दिस एपिडेमिक डिसीजेस. सो इन लेसर राइटिंग इन चैप्टर ऑब्जर्वेशंस ऑन स्कारलेट फीवर ऑन पेज नंबर 479 डॉक्टर हनीमन सेज the malignant scarlet fever that has prevailed in Germany for 8 years and proved fatal to many thousands of children and older persons, often so unexpectedly, so rapidly, with symptoms never before heard of under such circumstances. This murderous disease was termed as scarlet fever. So in lesser writings, there is a small case of scarlet fever or scarlet epidemic in Germany in 1799. He says there was a large family which was suffering with the epidemic of scarlet fever, in which there was a child who was not been affected with the epidemic, as the child was on belladonna since long for some other reason. So in a family, everybody was suffering with the scarlet fever, but there was only one child who was not suffering with it, instead of exposing with them, because he was on belladonna for some other reason since long. So Dr. Honeyman had to give a thought to it. Why did the child has not been affected with the scarlet fever? After conducting researches over the cases during epidemic scenario during that time, he came to conclusion that belladonna was a specific remedy or genus epidemicus for that particular epidemic of the scarlet fever. Then he laid down the guidelines for managing epidemics in this literature. So Dr. Honeyman himself says, which we never read, homeopathy appeals not only chiefly but solely to the verdict of experience. Repeat the experiments, whatever Dr. Honeyman has said, repeat them carefully and accurately, and you will find the doctrine confirmed at every step. So if you know your doctrine, exactly what it has written and how to approach in any case. So I think the question raised by someone about the 60-year-old man, it gets justified with this statement. So at any case, from a small child or a toddler to a 8-year-old patient, if we know the literature exactly, so homeopathy having great history of prevention of many epidemics since 200 years. One of the earliest tests of homeopathic system was in the treatment of typhus fever spreaded by the lice in 1831 epidemic, which followed the devastation of the Napoleon's army marching through Germany to attack Russia. Honeyman was able to treat 180 cases of typhus, losing but two. So this at a time when the conventional treatment were having a mortality rate of over 30%. So after that, homeopathy proved itself in managing many epidemics like cholera epidemic in 1831, cholera epidemic in 1854 in London, cholera epidemic 1855 Rio, diphtheria 1862 to 1864, yellow fever, Spanish flu 1981. So the recent epidemics of dengue fever has well responded with Epodotherium perfolatum. In all these epidemics, homeopathy has negligible percentage of mortality and higher rate of recovery as compared to conventional treatment. So we'll see what are the guidelines given in the Organon about epidemics. So there are many aphorisms given in the Organon about epidemic, how to find out the genus epidemicus, to whom to give and to whom not to give, and how it will work. So in aphorism number 100, Dr. Honeyman says, in the investigation of the symptom complex of epidemic or sporadic disease, it makes no difference if something similar has ever appeared before under the same or any other name. The novelty or peculiarity of such a contagion makes no difference, either in its examination or in its cure. Since the physician presupposes that the pure image of each and every presently reigning disease is new and unknown, he must explore it for himself from the ground up. Like any disease, like invariable infectious disorder such as smallpox, measles, etc. So what Honeyman mean to say in aphorism number 100? So in aphorism 100, it is narrated to take thorough case when investigating an epidemic or sporadic disease with few exceptions. Each reigning epidemic differs from all previous ones. Each epidemic has its own nature. It never repeats in the same manner. And each epidemic differs from the area to area also and country to country also. So we should not collect data from the other country and find genus epidemics. We should see the cases. First, we should see the cases, collect the data, then only we can come to a conclusion to some remedy as a specific or genus epidemicus. So treat each and every case as a different one with few exceptions. And in aphorism number 101, Dr. Honeyman says, it may well be that the physician does not get a perception of the complete image of the epidemic disease with the first case he encounters, since each such collective disease only brings the complex of its symptom to the light of day with closer observations of several cases. Meanwhile, the carefully investigating physician can often comes close to the true state. Even with the first or second patient, that he becomes alive to the characteristic image of the disease and then finds a fitting homeopathically commensurate remedy for it. So in aphorism number 101, Dr. Honeyman says that the symptom complex of epidemic diseases only comes through the observation of several cases involving different bodily constitutions. Dr. Honeyman laid down the principles of specific remedy for epidemic or genus epidemicus in this aphorism. So he says genus epidemicus is only formed by close observation of each and every case. Not only you have to take some 10, 20 cases and you have to form a genus epidemicus. some people have seen only two cases, and from those two cases, they have come to the conclusion that this is a genus epidemic. So you should not do like that. You have to take a good number of cases, study and compile to get genus epidemicus. Include only specific symptoms related to only present suffering and exclude all the specific symptoms which were there in his history or which he was suffering since long. Only you have to take the present totality. Based on that present totality, you have to select that specific remedy, or you have to come to the conclusion that this is a genus epidemicus. And a genus epidemicus or this specific remedy does not mean only one remedy. Genus epidemicus means it might be one remedy also, it might be more remedies also. So that set of remedies also becomes the genus epidemicus, because one after the another, you need a series of remedies to cure a case. You cannot cure a corona or any epidemic with only one remedy. So Dr. Honeyman says in the same aphorism as select one or more remedies based on the totality of the symptoms. So in aphorism number 102, Dr. Honeyman says, without understanding this aphorism, we cannot find a specific medicine or preventive medicine or genus epidemicus. This aphorism speaks about importance of multiple observations. So this aphorism says, upon recording the symptoms of several cases of this kind, the sketch of the disease image becomes more and more complete, not larger and more, but more characteristic, more encompassing of the peculiarity of this collective disease. On one hand, the general signs like, for example, loss of appetite, sleeplessness and all, obtain their own narrow determination. On the other hand, the more marked, particular, and at least in this connection, rarer symptoms belonging to only a few diseases emerge and form what is characteristic for this epidemic. So to be sure, all those afflicted by the epidemic at that time have the same disease following from one and the same source, flowing from one and the same source. However, the entire extent of such an epidemic disease and the totality of its symptom cannot be pursued in a single patient, but can only be completely abstracted and gathered from the sufferings of the several patients of different bodily constitutions. So have you understood this aphorism? So this aphorism says we have to take multiple cases, and in those multiple cases, we get the common symptoms, like general symptoms. First, we get two types of symptoms. One are common symptoms, which are common to all. And there are some peculiar symptoms, which are not there in all the cases. They differ from patient to patient. So we have two types of cases in the epidemic diseases. So where we find common symptoms in all, in those we can find out the genus epidemicus. But the patient which is having some different symptoms from the other patient, we have to give a different remedy for him, depending upon his peculiarity. So it means to all the patients, the genus epidemicus does not work. So in aphorism number 234, Dr. Honeyman says, those apparently non-febrile, typical, periodically recurring morbid states just alluded to observed in one single patient at a time, they do not usually appear sporadically or epidemically. Always belong to the chronic diseases, mostly to those that are purely psoriatic, or but seldom complicated with syphilis, and are successfully treated by the same means. Yet it is sometimes necessary to employ as an intermediate remedy a small dose of potentized solution of cinchona bark in order to extinguish completely their intermittent fever. So in aphorism number 234, Dr. Honeyman says, the apparently non-febrile intermittent diseases are always chronic and usually purely psoriatic, which sometimes may need cinchona as intermittent to cure them completely. So in FRS number 241, Dr. Honeyman says that epidemics of intermittent fever in situations where none are endemic are of the nature of chronic diseases composed of single acute paroxysm. Each single epidemic is of a peculiar uniform character common to all the individuals attacked. And when this character is found in the totality of the symptoms common to all, it guides us to the discovery of the homeopathic specific remedy suitable for all the cases, which is almost universally serviceable in those patients who enjoy tolerable health before the occurrence of the epidemic. That is to say, who were not chronic sufferers from the developed sora. So in this aphorism, Dr. Honeyman says, genus epidemicus, the so-called genus epidemicus, acts only on those patients who were not suffering with the developed sora already, who were enjoying a good health before this epidemic, and suddenly they will get this epidemic, and suddenly they will get this epidemic fever. Only in those cases it will act as a specific remedy or a preventive remedy, but it will not act in those patients who are already chronic sufferers. So in aphorism 241, Dr. Honeyman speaks about necessary conditions for prophylactic treatment, and it says, to find the remedy that is best for almost all patients in an epidemic are those who are not suffering from developed sora. Discover the symptoms common to all and prescribe preventive, but remember, it will not act in those cases who are already suffering with the developed sora. So there is one more aphorism about epidemic fevers, that is aphorism number 242, and it says, psoriatic intermittent fevers may develop if the first attacks of epidemic are left untreated, or the patient is treated or suppressed with the allopathy medicines. So like nowadays people are doing, whenever you get a fever or something, they are providing a kit with azithromycin 500 mg, vitamin C, vitamin D, vitamin E, and paracetamol, and some mild steroid like betnasol something and all. So what those kits will do, Honeyman written in aphorism number 242, those kits produce psoriatic intermittent fevers, because the first attack of the epidemic they will suppress with those medicines. So afterwards it will become more difficult to cure. Once you suppress those initial symptoms of some disease, not only corona, any disease. That's why Honeyman advised in Organon to take the journey of the disease, how it started from the beginning. So if we suppress the beginning only, then the disease will progress slowly, and it will become more difficult and more irreversible to cure. So that's why the patient who are taking this treatment, they are getting diabetes, hypertension, renal fever, failure, this, that. And once they get discharged also, and once they get claimed they are fit, they are cured, after coming home also, they are again getting admitted after a few days. It is because of this only, what Honeyman says in aphorism number 74 and what he says in aphorism number 242. And one more thing, when you get treated with these allopathy medicines, the organ which is affected, if you claim it as cured also, it will never cured, because the vitality which is weakened, the vital force which is weakened in that particular organ, it will remain for a long, unless and until you cure it naturally or homeopathically. So in future, if not now, in future also you will suffer many complications with that particular organ which is treated with the allopathy medicines, because it becomes susceptible for the future ailments. But Dr. Honeyman says, if they come with the suppression also, they can be subdued with minute and rarely repeated doses of sulfur or heparin sulf in high potencies. In high potencies, that does not mean 1 mm, 10 mm, 50 mcm. It does not mean those high potencies, because this is aphorism of 6th edition. Those who have read about the 6th edition, they can understand what is this high potencies. After that only you can handle these type of cases by getting a pure picture of the disease, because they present a mixed picture of the improper handling by the allopathic medicines. So we will go to the diet and regimen. Any question regarding this? These aphorisms or Honeyman in literature, anything you have not understood, please post on the chat box. So shall we move further? So the successes which are coming are the result of this. Yes, exactly. They are result of this only, actually. Because in the first wave, they have given lots of antibiotics, steroids and all, because of which the vitality of the patient became weak. Intermittent fever and COVID-19 are not the same. So the successive waves are coming because of the suppressive treatments, because of these harmful chemicals, harmful molecules which they use. Actually, they produce a mutant. If you give some remedy to produce antibiotic antibodies in the body, you know, any medicine or any injection which we give to produce antibodies so that you should not get affected with the corona. So what that molecule or that injection will do, you know, it will produce antibody if possible. It will produce antibodies for that particular mutant or for that particular COVID virus which was there at that time, if they are capable of producing. If they produced also, that virus will produce its different mutant, because it is already because it is a RNA virus. You give something to this RNA at this situation and try to produce antibodies, it will change its shape. It will get mutated and produce another mutant, which will become more harmful than the previous one. Understood? Like, for example, pehle hum log machhar ke liye sirf dhuan ye karte the. Wo dhuan jaake mutant produce for next generation. So in the next generation, that mosquito become more strong. Uske baad mein wo machhar ki batti aa gayi. उसके बाद मच्छर की बत्ती आ गई, फिर उसके मच्छर की बत्ती की वजह से भी मच्छर नहीं मरे, उसके बाद में वो कॉइल लिक्विड या गैस जो समथिंग है ना वो आ गया, अब उससे भी नहीं मर रहे, तो दे विल प्रोड्यूस देयर म्यूटेंट्स. And Dr. Geeta, so according to intermittent fevers and COVID-19 are the same as the intermittent fever, and COVID-19 is an epidemic and the epidemics are intermittent fevers. Intermittent fever is completely different, but that but the COVID-19 or some any epidemic or endemic, they come under the intermittent fevers. All aphorisms you told are related to, yeah, because any epidemic is intermittent fever, no? So we will discuss about the diet and regimen. What Dr. Honeyman has written, what our old Ayurvedic people used to do. So in lesser writings, Dr. Honeyman has written in the chapter Protection Against Infection in Epidemic Disease, page number 167. So he has written, every poisonous exhalation has its particular antidote. It's just that we do not know about it. The air of our atmosphere contains 2/3 of the gas that is fatal to man. Only one third is of vital air, wherein all creatures can live, grow and develop themselves. If the patient is not too weak, he may change his room and bed every day, and the room to be well aired by opening the doors and all the windows so that air is well circulated, which is not available in the hospitals. Nowadays, you see, we take a patient and throw him in the ICU, where ICU is completely closed, where there is no window, and there is completely this, they have installed those ACs, centralized ACs or some ACs. And you know what those ACs do? They produce cold air, no? So see their logic. Actually, they only tell not to expose to the cold things, and they admit the patient in a room where it is extremely cold. So the dampness also increases the disease, also becomes it more incurable. So if you are not in a proper ventilated room, no, it will be, if the room is damp, if the room is cold, whether it is ICU, whether it is home, the disease will start progressing. So we gradually accustom ourselves to the most poisonous exhalations and remain pretty well in the midst of epidemic. But in accustoming ourselves in advance from one extreme to the other, must be made with caution and by every small degrees. The ones who get affected suddenly die. But the ones who were exposed were gradually accustomed to the atmosphere and enjoy a tolerable good health. So here Dr. Honeyman says, we need to get exposed to this corona or epidemic or anything. You will, hum log dar ke sab mask pehen ke pura aisa bhoot ki jaisa ho kya to rehta na, PPE ko test sab pehen ke mask bandh ke aankh ke upar chashma, uske upar fir ye gloves, fir din mein 10 bar hand sanitize karo, patient ko 100 foot dur se baat karo. So isse actually your immunity will decrease. You need to expose to the patient. If not to the severe cases, at least to the mild cases you need to expose, then only your immunity will improve. Then only you will become immune to the upcoming waves. Actually, anybody knows what will that mask, that hand sanitizer, that six meter distance, what that everything will do? Whether it is really needed. If it is needed, to what extent it is needed. If it is not needed, then why it is not needed? It is not much needed, because to develop your immunity, you have to expose to these conditions, no? These organisms, these diseases. If not completely, at least little by little, you have to get exposed. So a physician, after taking proper precautions and due care, we may remain beside patient for some time to feel the pulse and examine tongue and have to refrain from breathing when so near. तो इतना ही करना है हमको, जब पूरा जब क्लोज रहते हैं तब उतना ही थोड़ा ब्रीदिंग को रुकाना है, जब उसको एग्जामिन करते हैं तब, जब उसको टच करते हैं उस टाइम में उतना ही है। डॉक्टर हनीमन ने बोला है कि दैट टाइम वी शुड नॉट टेक द ब्रीथ। उसका मतलब ये नहीं कि मास्क पहनो, 10 बार हाथ धो, ऐसे टच करते ही हाथ धो। फॉर एनी केस वी हैव टू sanitize our hands. In home also we have to wear a mask. So this all is not needed. So infections easily gets transferred through infected cloths as they carry contagious matter. Depressing mental emotions render persons susceptible to miasm. So depressing mental emotions like anxiety, like fear, actually जितनों को भी ये हो रहा है ना, it is because of their anxiety and fear. वो लोग समझते हैं कि अगर मैं बाहर गया, patient को अगर देखा तो it will, ये मुझे भी हो जाएगा, और patient को बिठाते हैं clinic से, clinic के बाहर जो road है उससे भी दूर, वहाँ पे बिठा के वहाँ remedy देते हैं उसको, because they have fear and anxiety inside, and that is a negative emotion, and that negative emotion will invite to the disease and invite to the miasm. It is an invitation for the miasm and invitation for the disease. अगर आप डर के घर में भी बैठेंगे, किसी से भी एक्सपोज नहीं होंगे, ऐसे बहुत से लोग हैं जिनको कोरोना हुआ है। When we visit patients, need to maintain our mind and body in good equilibrium, like in state of anger or grief or over exertion of the mind, are great promoters of infection. हम लोग पहले पेशेंट को डर डर के देखेंगे तो ऑब्वियसली इट विल क्रिएट अ नेगेटिव इन्फेक्शन इंप्रेशन ऑन योर माइंड एंड इट एक्ट्स एज अ इनविटेशन फॉर द इन्फेक्शन, बिकॉज नेगेटिव इमोशंस विल लोअर डाउन योर इम्यूनिटी एंड वाइटलिटी। So whatever kind of epidemic fever the disease might be, in such cases I have taken a dram of cinchona bark in every 3/4 of an hour until all danger of infection is over. It is written in the lesser writings. All over fatigue of the body, chills and night watching should be avoided. The first and foremost diet in COVID and after COVID is avoiding expectoration producing foods and drinks like juices, extracts, milk products and cold things. हम लोग दवा दवा के उसको इतना देते हैं, इतना स्टीम देते हैं, इतना गर्म पानी देते हैं कि उसका म्यूकस सिर्फ मुंह से नहीं, बाकी सब जगह से इतना दे देते हैं हम लोग। एंड यू ऑल नो द व्हाट हैपेंड विद दोस पीपल हु ड्रिंक काढ़ा एंड ऑल। एक्चुअली इन old Ayurvedic people, they said drink kadha for to reduce the dampness of the body, drink kadha and warm drinks for only 7 days, then avoid it for a month, then after a month again you have to do it for 7 days. But what we are doing, what the people are doing, you know, they are drinking those kadhas for months together और इतना पी रहे हैं कि बहुत लोगों को पाइल्स हो गया है। सो ये पाइल्स से मुझे याद है, वन ऑफ माय फ्रेंड हैज सेंट दिस जोक कि दोज हु अंडरस्टैंड हिंदी, जिस तरह लोग अंधाधुंध काढ़ा पी रहे हैं, तीसरी लहर बवासीर करने आ जाएगा। So everybody is waiting for the third wave, no? So we all know that in ancient systems of medicine like Ayurveda, Siddha, acupuncture, etc., the first and foremost thing in the respiratory disease is to avoid things which produce or increase kapha. Means the things which produce excess dampness or water imbalance in the body. Kapha means excess dampness or water imbalance. Avoiding things which increase kapha in the body is the most important understanding of them, especially in respiratory diseases. Avoid using AC and living in cold and damp places, which is common in ICUs nowadays. Avoid excess sleep in the day and remaining awake till late night. Do regular exercise and avoid excess fried and oily foods. Yeah, third is wave is possible. Because we are vaccinating the people, no? That too forcibly and with compulsion. So not only third wave, fourth, fifth, sixth wave, all waves are possible. Till it becomes OCA. So what would be the diet in acute disease? These epidemics are acutes, no? They are not chronic. So what would be the diet? There is no universal diet like universal food. Go with the desires and aversion of the patient. Our vital force knows what is needed and what is not needed to heal itself. If the patient is not having good appetite, we should not force him to eat. It causes loss of energy in digestion of the food. You understand, many patients or their relatives says, usko patient hamara khai nahi raha hai, bhale ho marne do, lekin wo khana chahiye, aisa hai. भले उसके मुंह से लेके पूरे इंटेस्टाइन तक अल्सर हो, फट गया हो सब कुछ, लेकिन वो मैटर नहीं करता है, वो खाना चाहिए, ऐसा है। और हम लोग भी उसी के पीछे लग जाते हैं, बिकॉज वी डोंट अंडरस्टैंड दिस पॉइंट। इफ द पेशेंट इज नॉट हैविंग गुड एपेटाइट, वी शुड नॉट फोर्स हिम टू ईट। इट कॉजेस लॉस ऑफ एनर्जी इन डाइजेशन ऑफ द फूड, बिकॉज दैट एनर्जी इज नीडेड टू फाइट विद द इन्फेक्शन रनिंग इनसाइड। So it is a nature's defense mechanism. So give proper medicine. If you give proper medicine, it automatically activates the demand for food. If we force to eat, it will cause hindrance or harm the patient or cause obstacle in cure. Don't give too much IV salines. It will cause acute renal crisis. इसीलिए तो जितने भी hospitals आ रहे हैं, they are going into renal crisis, acute renal failure. Or some renal changes, cardiac changes, all these are because of this only. So in aphorism, so in aphorism number 262 and 263, Dr. Hanuman has given the diet in acute disease. The best regimen for acute illness involves satisfying the patient's cravings within moderate bounds, along with avoidance of mental exertion and emotional shocks. So Dr. Zurian Khan says the need to wear mask is because we do not know who is carrier or infected person, as some patients are asymptomatic, just as a preventive measures. So do you know, can you prove these masks act as a preventive? Those people who wear the mask, they get prevented from the disease. Not only mask, if they wear that whole PPE kit, like the ghost, whether they get prevented by the disease. How this simple mask act as a preventive measure? Any evidence? risk is reduced. Risk will not reduce by wearing the mask. Risk will reduce by not taking the allopathy medicines. I have seen lots of corona cases without mask only. Me and Dr. Salman, Dr. Rangraj, we have seen the cases of the corona cases. In the first wave also, in the second wave also. And from moderate, and from mild, moderate to severe also, without the mask. We wear mask only when the patient is coughing on our face. Uski muh ki badbuo ki wajah se utna hi hum log pehante the. Baaki utna kuch hai. To humko kuch bhi risk aisa hona tha na phir. Yeah, that we don't know whose immunity is strong. But it does not mean wearing a mask will increase your immunity. Instead, wearing a mask will decrease your immunity because you are inhaling your own carbon dioxide. So mask is needed as per the Honeyman only when you are very close with the patient, means when you are closely observing or closely examining the patient, not at the 6 meter distance or not sitting the patient outside the clinic or something like that. Vaccination. If I talk about vaccination, it will be against the government. On my this sentence only, you can understand what will be my opinion about the vaccination. What is the role of vaccination exactly? As you all know, vaccines will produce antibodies, no? Antibodies against what? Antibodies against that coronavirus, right? Whenever you produce artificial antibodies in the body, it will get mutated and it will come with more harmful mutant. So do you know this coronavirus is basically a RNA virus. RNA virus ka hum log vaccine nahi bana sakte. You know why? Because RNA virus has the quality to mutate. For example, aaj jo coronavirus ka state hai, kal wo hi nahi rehta hai. Jaise, for example, aaj hum log coronavirus ko sher samajh ke, tiger samajh ke maarne ke liye banduk leke aa rahe hain. Jaise hum log banduk leke aate hain, wo change hoke machhar ho jata hai. To banduk se machhar marega? जैसे मच्छर को मारने के लिए हम लोग बैट लेके आते हैं वो बिल्ली बन जाता है. तो ऐसे ही वैक्सीन का रोल है. इन शॉर्ट यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड हाईलाइट रोल ऑफ वैक्सीनेशन इन कोविड-19. देयर इज नो वैक्सीनेशन इन होम्योपैथी. सो हाउ कैन आई हाईलाइट होम्योपैथिक प्रोस्पेक्टिव? होम्योपैथिक प्रोस्पेक्टिव इज दैट फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल दोज पेशेंट हु आर ऑलरेडी ऑन द होम्योपैथी ट्रीटमेंट सिंस लॉन्ग, they have good immunity. So मेरे जितने भी अब तक patients हैं homeopathy के, मैंने इतनी practice में जितने भी देखे हैं जो continuous हैं, उनको किसी को corona नहीं हुआ. और if you take the vaccine also, no, we have remedy for the side effect of those vaccines also. And the role of vaccination in COVID-19, as I said, it will produce a more dangerous mutant in the future. Because you put this ऐसे बहुत researches हैं. Italy research says COVID is a bacteria and some people say there is no COVID only. तो किसका माने किसका छोड़े. कुछ लोग बोलते हैं कि हायर एंटीबायोटिक से कम होता है, कुछ लोग एंटीवायरल से कम होता है, कुछ लोग थाली बजाने से कम होता है, किससे कम होता है क्या पता नहीं है ऐसा। सर पेशेंट विद एचआईवी और एड्स कैन बी क्योर्ड और नॉट, आई थिंक इट इज डिफिकल्ट, या इट इज डिफिकल्ट ओनली बट दे कैन बी क्योर्ड। यू नो डॉक्टर डेरबीशर, एनीबडी नोज अबाउट डॉक्टर डेरबीशर अदर देन डॉक्टर रंगराजा एंड डॉक्टर सलमान? Dr. Germisher is a homeopath who is practicing in South Africa in an area where all most of them are HIV positive cases only. And he is having 100% results. Till now, he has cured more than 10,000 cases. With CD4 count 3-4 like that. He has cured those cases also. People are not recovering by antibiotics. People are getting suppressed by the antibiotics and antivirals. As I said in the aphorism number 74, no? They are not recovering. Actually, if they recover also, it is a very mild case, and they are having very few symptoms which may or may not belong to the COVID, but those which are belong to the COVID or coronavirus, those mild cases, no, when we give antibiotics, they are not recovering, they are getting suppressed. After some days, what will happen? That disease will slowly progress inside the body. So that's why those cases become from mild to moderate. Then again, there we give antibiotics and antivirals. Then again, we claim it is recovered. Then again, after some time, that case will become severe. And if they claim it is really get cured with those antibiotics and antivirals, and the patient is not suffering with any symptom for long, but definitely it is because of their good immunity and vitality. But definitely in the future, when their immunity gets lowered or their vitality gets lowered, that organ remained as a susceptible organ in their body because it is not cured, it is suppressed. And in the future, they will suffer with the lung collapse, this, that. Nowadays, we are seeing, no? Those cured cases, so-called cured cases of corona, having intestinal gangrene. I have seen a case of intestinal gangrene. Those so-called cured cases of the corona having black fungus. Then if it is cured with antibiotics and antivirals, then why they are suffering with these diseases? And the people, and oh, you know, vaccination contains that mercury at a higher level and aluminium dioxide, I think. So if you understand that mercury and aluminium in a homeopathic sense, someone asked about the vaccination, no? Ab jaake government samne bata mat dena. Phir bhi main bata raha hu. That aluminium and mercury, if you understand homeopathically what they do, in which cases we give, what is the sphere of action of that aluminium and that mercury in homeopathy, that Mercol and Alumina? They act on the nervous system. They act on the psychological level. That's why in America or US or somewhere, many people who got vaccinated, they are getting nightmares. They are getting dreams of ghosts, fear of ghosts. And many people have lost their sense of reasoning. So don't go with what media says. Just you read what it is. Just you investigate what it is. You discover what it is. What is the content of that vaccine? What is the content of that antibiotic? And what it will do. No, it will, though they will not act as what you are telling, those metals in potentized form and in chemical form aren't same in action. No. Because homeopathy acts on similia similibus curantur. That doesn't mean same metal you have, same material you have to give. For vaccinated people, you have to give Marksol and aluminum. The logic will not work like that. You have to take the case only. You have to take the case. What symptoms he is suffering with after that vaccination, then only you have to prescribe. And we have good medicines in homeopathy to tackle with the side effects of the vaccination if you take also and if you are forced to take also. So any other question? According to you, to whom you tell the case is severe? Homeopathy treats severe cases, you are asking, no? Whether it will cure or not. So according to you, to whom you call it as a severe case of corona, what scoring, what level of oxygen? So the oxygen level below 90 is a severe case. And in the HRCT, the score of above 15 is a severe case, isn't it? And also, now it is a severe case. Now the difficult case is the patient who is having saturation below 90 and scoring above 15 and also with the comorbidities. So whether we can cure it or not, you are asking only the severe corona patients whose saturation is below 90 and whose HRCT is around 15, scoring is around 15. So these are claimed as severe cases according to those radiologists, according to the media, and according to those doctors, not by us. So I am asking whether with homeopathy we can cure the cases with this saturation below 90, scoring above 15, and with the comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, cardiac problem, renal problem. You will get your answer in my case which I have treated. I will show later. So any more regarding this diet and regimen? Any more questions? So in aphorism number 263, Dr. Hanuman said the demand in acute diseases are for the things which give palliative relief to the patient. The temperature of the room and the warmth or coolness of the bed coverings must be arranged according to the wish of the patient. All mental exertions and emotional shock should be kept away from the patient. See the last point, all mental exertions, emotional shock should be kept away from the patient. Lekin hum log aise le jagah pe leke jaake usko admit karte hain jiske aajubaju se dead bodies jaate rehte hain. तो देख के ये भी बेचारा मरेगा ही ना, चाहे कोरोना से मरे या ना मरे, और डर के तो मर ही जाएगा. सो दिस टाइप ऑफ केसेस वी हैव सीन मेनी इन यंग बॉयज आल्सो, वी हैव सीन हु हैव डाइड विद द फियर. सो द फुटनोट टू 263 सेज अक्यूट इल पेशेंट्स रेयरली क्रेव थिंग्स दैट ऑब्स्ट्रक्ट क्योर. इन अक्यूट diseases, deciding diet is very easy because it comes from the patient. So the possible homeopathy remedies for mild cases, we can try. These are not the confirmed ones. Huh? Just for the beginners, I have added these remedies. For the initial stage, we can prescribe belladonna, ferrum, phosphorus, aconite, gelsinium. If anybody wants to take, you can take the pick of this slide. But it does not mean you can give first belladonna, then ferrum, then phosphorus, then aconite, then one after the another. It does not mean that. You have to take the case first, then you have to match with one of these remedies. So in the first wave, as me and my colleagues like Dr. Salman, Dr. Rangaraj, Dr. Vikas, we have seen the cases of corona and treated with homeopathy. So in the first wave, Brayona played a major role in the first wave. It covered almost all the symptoms of the COVID-19 last year. Brayona cured most of the cases. Dry mouth, headache when moving, severe body ache, backache, and bitterness in the mouth validates Brayona. It can also be considered as prophylaxis, as it is covering almost all the symptoms from beginning to end and the pathology, including pneumonia also. So this year, we will not have same loss of sense of taste and smell as the last year. So this year, the scenario is same, but bit different. In this second wave, a second pattern or wave is seen as severe headache, severe diarrhea, severe fatigue, and sore throat, which was very rare in the first wave. So if we look at this pattern of the severe diarrhea, severe fatigue, severe headache, no? Then Silesia covers almost all the symptoms, but it did not give significant result. It is not my comment. Actually, one of my colleague or someone, he has posted about Silesia. So according to him, he says Silesia covers almost all the symptoms, but did not give significant result. But chinina musk cured diarrhea and fatigue quickly. Glonine is effective in relieving headaches quickly. Rumex and Squila are well tolerated for sore throat and cough in this second wave. So the number of cases of sudden decrease in oxygen saturation, rapid onset of pneumonia, as well as fibrosis of the lungs is increasing day by day. The death toll is rising accordingly. Carbovage is still in the forefront of maintaining oxygen saturation and combined with Brayona, Veratrum, Viridae, etc. fights with the pneumonia. Phosphorus gives life back in abundant cases. Antimers can relieve the shortness of the breath. It should come with lot of symptoms. Antigen and RT-PCR do not take long time to become negative. Even so, giving pulsatilla respectively can do just that. Only if the totality matches with the pulsatilla, you should not give pulsatilla to make RT-PCR negative. In the second wave, phosphorus played a major role in handling COVID cases like Brayona in the first wave. So the post-COVID complications which we have seen is with much mucus and lung fibrosis, where the doctors have advised for the lung transplantation, this, that, and so in those cases also, homeopathy did a marvelous work. Actually, I have seen some 2-3 cases in which I have given only these three remedies. After that, I have given a series of remedies also, but these remedies played a major role in the cuff and lung fibrosis. That is bryonia, chyliaeode, and chyliars. And the cases with loose motions have responded well with the veratrum album, arsenic, and also I have prescribed oleander, I think, chininum, arsine, camphor. So I have seen the patient with cardiac complications also, and with renal artery blockage also, and with the DVTs also, where the majority major role was played by the Lorisius, Cactus, and Oromet in the cardiac complications. And in DVTs and other blockages of heart, Cortalis horridus, Lachesis arnica, and arsenic acted very well. So with the headaches, we have given those common remedies, Belladonna, Natrum Carb, Lonine, Naxamethan. With weakness and prostration, you can give any acid because all acids have weakness in the center. All China, like China and chininum, are have weakness in the center. Stannum, Met, Natrum, they all have weakness and prostration in the center. So Natrum is the most important drug after any common cold. It facilitates the termination of the cold, conserves strength and appetite. So whoever comes with the weakness after common cold or any viral fever, you can try Natrumers and Carbogage for the racking cuff, oppression of the chest, cold extremities, and bronchitis. So in cases with hyponatremia and hypokalemia, you can try Natrum for hyponatremia, Natrums for hyponatremia. And Kalis, as they are potassiums only, you can try Kalis. But in one or two cases, I have prescribed chyliaiode in hypokalemia where it is responded well, and Natrumers in hyponatremia. And the patient who come with anxiety neurosis, means many patients come with before also and after also, before COVID also and after COVID also, many patients come with the anxiety, you know, we will also get COVID and we will also die, this. Again, this for corona came, this like this. So in those cases, chyliaiodes and aconite in non-COVID, COVID and post-COVID cases played a major role in reducing their anxiety and panic state. Even arsenic also played a good role in reducing the anxiety. Even Rustox, where the patient became restless. So in nightmares, dreams, delusions of ghost, majority of the remedies are used from the Solanaceae family. You know which are the remedies from the Solanaceae family? Anybody knows? What are the remedies from Solanaceae family? At least one, two, or three. Yeah, Belladonna, Stramonium, Hyoscyamus, Capsicum. So these all belong to Solanaceae family. So I have 2 to 3 cases of this black fungus and one case of intestinal gangrene. Still, they are not cured, but they are on homeopathy treatment and doing very good. Now I cannot claim they are completely cured, but the remedies which gave good result are arsenic and Cortalis horridus. And along with that, according to situation, I have prescribed arnica, Belladonna, Lachesis. Even Glonine also has been prescribed. But in those black fungus and intestinal gangrenes, the major role was played by the arsenic only. all other remedies are given according to the situation or the present totality or situational totality as a situational remedy or as a state remedy. So the remedies prescribed are purely based on my own experience, and these are probable remedies, not the final concluded ones. Remedies were differed from patient to patient depending upon the totality of symptom and PQRS. One remedy plays a vital role in handling the case, like bromine in first wave and phosphorus in the second wave, followed by series of remedies depending upon change in the state or present totality. So this is a remedy at a whole level, which is a very big. We will discuss later if the time. If the time permits. So now it is clear. Now the voice is clear.
Yeah, it's clear, sir. It is clear.
Okay. Thank you. So Plato says, if you do not take an interest in the affairs of your government, then you are doomed to live under the rule of fools. Government means not BJP government, Congress government, or political government. It means any government or any body or any organization. Like in our discussion, it is homeopathy. It means if you do not take an interest in the affairs of your homeopathy, in the affairs of what Hahnemann has written, what originally written in the Hahnemann literature, then obviously you will follow the recent stalwarts, recent schools of thought, which are not completely based on these Hahnemann's teachings. They take one aphorism from the Organon and erect their whole concept on only that one aphorism. So if you follow those people, then you are doomed to live under the rule of those fools. If you don't understand properly the teachings of the Hahnemann. So now we will discuss the cases, because that is the time, as the time is running short. So someone asked the case, severe case, whether we can cure with homeopathy or not. So just see this case. So this is a COVID positive case of a 49-year-old lady with comorbidities also of diabetes and hypertension, came to homeopathy with the following HRCT scan and complaints. So when she came, her HRCT scan shows the score 22 out of 25. Actually, we have cases where the scoring is 25 out of 25 also, and the saturation is below 70. I have those reports, but I don't have after reports, but people ask for the proof now, so I have presented this case. Otherwise, other cases we have where the saturation is below 70, around 60, and the score is out 25 out of 25. So the report says multiple diffuse wedge-shaped patchy opacities and grand glass ground opacities noted in the both the lungs, likely a typical or viral pneumonia, CORODS 5. CT severity score is 22 out of 25. So the case started like this. I told her to tell the journey of the disease. So she said, some 8 days back, I had fever with chills for which I took allopathy treatment. So there she suppressed her initial symptoms. So after taking allopathy treatment, her fever reduced for 3 days. But again, since 2 days, fever and cough and all started. So then she came to homeopathy. So when I took the case in the uni, she was having the mild fever, continuous dry cough, which gets aggravated from talking in the night and which gets emulated by drinking water. she is having breathlessness on walking, coming from toilet, while rising from the bed, dryness of mouth and throat, with increased thirst. So she is having bitter taste in the mouth for food and liquids both, mild headache and body ache, irritability from the irritability from noise. Her SpO2 was 72 to 74 without oxygen. So what do you think, what might be the remedy? What should we give to this patient? Anybody? Based on these symptoms, what you feel, which remedy should we give? Except Dr. Ashfaq Kustadi, everybody said Bruinian. So the remedy given is Bruinian LM potency. Yes, all are right, because dryness of mouth, increased thirst. But patient will not tell like that. It is an edited case. So for easy understanding, we make the case to, we edit the case so that everybody can understand. So the remedy prescribed was Bruinia LM1 every 15 minutes for 3 hours. So anybody can comment on this every 15 minutes for 3 hours. Why I have given? What are the Hanumanian guidelines? When to repeat, when not to repeat? Yeah, exactly. Aphorism 246. So in acute cases, we can repeat. In acute cases, we can repeat from every 10 minutes to every hour, and we need to see the results within hours, not for the days. So this COVID is an acute disease. It is acute. If either it is acute disease or it is a exacerbation of the latent SORA. So you should get the result within hours, not in days. Not usually, you should not admit the patient for 1 month and bring his dead body to the home. If it is a right remedy, or if it is a right medicine, or if it is a right antibiotic, or if it is a right vaccine, or if it is a right antiviral, then the patient should improve within hours, not days. So I advised her to inform the condition and SpO2 every hour. Give hot water, hot food, hot clothes, isolate in good ventilated room. Every morning, make her to sit under sunlight for at least half hour. Don't give non-veg, oily or cold food, or those vitamin C, vitamin E, vitamin D. So that everything I told her not to take. So on the day one, during treatment, after 1 hour, means after fourth dose, I wanted to know whether her saturation is increasing or not, because it is around 79 and it is, according to, it is very severe condition. So for me also, it was a very severe condition. So I told them to inform after 1 hour. So after fourth dose, her SpO2 started increasing from 72 to 76. Then after 3 hours, her SpO2 increased from 72 to 76, then to 78, then now it became 82. Then I am convinced that this remedy is right and it is on the way to its cure. Then after 3 hours, her cough almost reduced. she started feeling fresh. Dryness of mouth is also reduced. But breathlessness not changed. Because it is the night and I told her to continue the remedy till she gets sleep and inform me in the morning. Then on next day, the SpO2 became 82 to 83. Then I told them to continue the medicine every half hourly till the evening and inform me in the evening. So by the evening, her breathlessness also reduced almost 50%. Only bit cough remained, which comes on and off sometimes. No fever, no body ache, and no headache. Breathing became easy compared to yesterday. Yesterday, she was having heavy breathing, which is not sufficient for her. Dryness of mouth and throat is very less now. Then on the third day, SpO2 became 87 to 88. Then there are no complaints of fever and all. Mild breathlessness on motion. But those all symptoms of the dryness of mouth, breathlessness on exertion, that everything went. And she started getting weakness. She said, I'm feeling very weak. Loss of taste is still there. And she has developed a new symptom. Urination, increase in urination and frequency and quantity. So I have changed the remedy from the bryonia to the acid first, because now the bryonia state has gone, that dryness, that breathlessness on exertion, everything is gone, that body ache, that headache, everything is gone. And the new symptom came up, that is increased frequency in the urination, and also the quantity of urination is also increased. And she has developed a new symptom, that is weakness. So when we take the follow-up, no, we have to see whether new symptoms are coming or not. Whether the new symptoms are coming, we have to wait for some time. If they go automatically, it is well and good. If they don't go, then we have to change the remedy based on those symptoms, not the old symptoms. Then on the fifth day, her SpO2, this all is without oxygen. I have not given her oxygen. So on the day five, SpO2 increased from 90 to 91. Weakness is reduced, but feeling weak in the chest while talking, coughing and all. Urination problem is also reduced. Tastelessness is still there. Breathlessness only while speaking. So I advised for prone ventilation and blowing balloons or spirometer. So based on this change in totality, where the weakness is centralized in the chest, which is not there in the bryonia while prescribing bryonia or phosphoric acid. Now the new symptom came, which is feeling weak in the chest while talking. And one more new symptom is nothing, only that symptom. Otherwise, all the weakness reduced. So I have prescribed Tanamet LM1. On day seven, all the complaints has reduced. Her SpO2 increased from 72 on the day one to 94 to 95. Now she is having occasionally mild dry cough. Tastelessness is still remaining, sometimes bitter. Now she's developed this stool problem. Stool became unsatisfactory. To pass the stool, she has to strain. So based on that, I have prescribed her Nuxvomica. So on day 15th, her SpO2 became 96 to 97. Now there are no complaints. So I have prescribed few doses of antipsoriatic to end the case, because I have changed a lot of remedies and they played as a state simulium. No? So sometimes there may be chances of disease coming back. So I have prescribed some doses of sulfur to end the case, as I don't have symptoms. Other psoriatic symptoms to prescribe any other antipsoriatic remedy. So as anyone advised, if you don't get antipsoriatic remedy or symptoms which point to the antipsoriatic remedy, then prescribe some doses of sulfur. And I have advised them to repeat the scan on 30th day, but they did on the 20th day only. After giving some doses of sulfur for 3-4 days, they did out of curiosity that HRCT scan on the 20th day, where the total score from 22, it came to 8. and the impressions shows bilateral subtle ground glass opacities and associated fibrotic opacities suggested sequel of viral or interstitial pneumonia. Compared to previous scan, the present scan shows significant resolution of the bilateral ground glass opacities. So after 20 days also, that scoring is reduced and the lung is under resolution, is under cure, and the patches are getting resolved. So I have not told them to repeat the scan after 30 days. So it is enough for me, as she is not having any symptoms also. And reports are also showing that there is a resolution in the grass ground opacities. So this is the first case. Any doubt in the case? Any doubt in the case? Okay, no doubt. Not prematurely. She is having the symptom of weakness and profuse urination. No? Prematurely means we have to predict she will urinate in the future profusely. That is called as premature. When the symptoms are present of severe weakness, profuse urination, that indicates it is a time to change the remedy. Why NV? Because again, the totality of the symptom changed, no? The older symptoms got resolved and some new symptoms are coming up, which are not of the remedy also. So if they are coming because of the acid foss or stannamet, then we have waited for it. We have stopped the stannamet. I think NV is given after stannamet or acid foss. I don't know. It is given, I think, after stannamet or acid foss. So if it is a symptom of that straining for stool and unsatisfactory stool is because of acid foss, then I would have stopped the acid foss for few days. Then automatically that symptom will go, but it is not a symptom of the acid foss. Patient was having hypertension and diabetes, no. That is chronic only. It is a known case of hypertension and diabetes since long. Can we prescribe LM potency hourly, sir? I have prescribed in every 15 minutes. Not hourly also. Every 15 minutes I have given her a dose. Yeah, during that time, her diabetes and hypertension had actually, BP was not raised, but I think that sugar has shooted to something around 200, for which we have not interfered, because the body goes into stress. No, that time automatically that hypertension and diabetes will increase. That does not mean we have to give insulin. We have to give, but she was already on those hypertensive and this diabetic tablets. But after the case finished, so now she is a regular patient of mine. Now she is on homeopathy treatment for this hypertension, diabetes, and some arthritis problem. Yeah, they were monitored. They were he was having this no glucometer. I have that chatting history also, but now that time is not there. Those sugar levels were monitored and they were under control. They not went up to 300, 400, 500. If they go also, then what you will do? You will give insulin. It is a body's defense mechanism. You have to, if that sugar becomes 300, 400, 500 or 800, if it produces symptoms in you, then only you have to prescribe. So the someone said no premature this prescription. So these are premature prescriptions actually, when the patient is having high sugars but no symptoms, then we give insulins, antihypertensive, and the patient will start getting symptoms because of their those medicines, because of those suppressive medicines, not because of that high sugars and this. And if the he produces some symptoms because of the high sugar, then we have to treat those symptoms automatically. That sugar, that hypertension, everything will come down. Who have low vitality, show me any state, sir. Yeah, definitely. Low vitality does not mean weakness. Low vitality means low vitality of a particular organ. If the patient is taking allopathy treatment when he was not born also, from since that time he is taking allopathy, then his each and every organ start becoming weak. His each and every organ's vitality will start reducing. So in future, he will suffer with one by one diseases like that. Yeah, right, actually. Dr. Salman said exactly. Actually, in between that, acid fuss is also a good remedy for diabetes, no? So Dr. Salman said in between was the acid fuss state showing symptom of the diabetes prominently. That's true. Actually, it was but I did not recognize it, but I think it was a symptom of the diabetes, high sugars, that weakness and that profuse urination. And acid fuss is also a good remedy in the diabetes. Yes, any other question? No, it is not necessary to repeat the CT scan. That's why I told in the aphorism number 74 and in the aphorism number 242, I think. He allow us do repeated scannings, repeated blood investigations. What they will do? What those repeated scannings, repeated? So, whom you want to prove? So if you want to prove to the allopaths, they will not get convinced if you give the CT scan, thousands of CT scan reports also, unless and until you challenge them to treat with us. You have to challenge them to, you bring 10 patients of yours and 10 patients of ours, and we'll see after 15 days whose results are good, who got cured and who got multiple diseases after going from there here. So CT scan reports are not necessary unless and until the patient is having severe symptoms. It is to convey anyhow, not even a single report is necessary. They are necessary only to convince the patient's relatives or the patient. If suddenly the patient dies, then they will not understand why he had died. They will think that because of our treatment, the patient died. So to make them understand the severity of the disease, sometimes we need to do the CT scan. Based on the CT scan, based on the reports, it is only allopaths can prescribe. For us, it is not necessary. Whatever the scanning report may come, whether it comes cancer also, we prescribe on the totality of the symptom, no, not on the reports. As Dr. Kent, I think he said, pathology is the end product of the disease, not the proper disease. So the disease begins much earlier than it is coming on the body level. So we have to understand that journey, not these reports. Your CT scan exposes the already weakened patient to strong radiation. Okay, any other questions? Shall we discuss two more cases in short and we will finish it? Till then you ask a question, put your questions. I will finish these two cases. These are of only one slide. So this is the second case. This is a COVID positive case of a 50-year-old lady, which is also known case of ILDs. Interstitial lung disease, came with the following HRCT scan and complaints. So her scoring was Cohort's 5 and the total score was 11/5. And it shows these are the these features are suggest crazy paving pattern she was having, and it shows highly suspicious for COVID-19 infection, and the total severity score is 11/5 Cohort's 5. So this was the case. Patient came with the complaints of pain in the throat with soreness on speaking, dry cough with tickling causing abdominal pain, cough worse by speaking, lying on back, turning in bed, and is better by sitting up. Fever with loss of taste and smell. SpO2 was 80 to 81. So depending upon this totality only, I have prescribed the remedy. So can you please tell which remedy may come up? Which remedy covers this totality? Yes, anybody? In the first case, Brevinia played a major role, followed by those remedies like acid fos, stanamate, nexamica. But Brevinia played a major role in increasing the saturation, bringing the patient back to the normal state. But it does not mean only Brevinia can cure the whole case. Dr. Shivshankar, phosphorus. Dr. Ashfaq Ustad, phosphorus. Hyosiamus. So the remedy prescribed is phosphorus. Phosphorus LM1 in LM potency. So that was the before treatment report where the scoring was 11 out of 25 with patchy pavements in the lungs. And this is after treatment. The impression shows features suggestive of interstitial lung disease, which was already old she was suffering, already old disease she was suffering. And now the Cohort score became 1, that is normal or non-infective. Before the Cohort was 5 and score was 11, I think. 11/25. and this is the case 3. So this is the third case. This is a case of COVID of 55-year-old male, which is also known case of cirrhosis of liver, diabetes mellitus, and hypertension, who came to homeopathy with the following HRCT reports, and his HRCT reports were showing those all ground glass OPT, opacities, patchy pigments, that everything was there. Along with that, his total score was 5 out of 25, and choroid was 5, means it is choroid 5 means it is a COVID case, but scoring is less. But it is a very complicated case with cirrhosis of liver, IHD, diabetes, hypertension, many diseases he was having. So he was having fever with chills on and off, fever with chills more in the evening, burning of the eyes, loss of appetite, flatulence, hyperacidity, nausea while eating, extreme weakness, mild headache and mild dry cough. And the SpO2 was 85 to 87. So can anybody tell the remedy? Which remedy it is? I was able to see these many cases of COVID only because of Dr. Imran Topichand from Belgaum. He is my one of the best friend. He referred many cases of COVID to me, and I used to take the case, and he used to do the follow-ups, and he also never used the mask and all. Instead of, actually, he also do the GP also and homeopathy also. Because of him, I have seen many cases of this black fungus also, and this COVID also. He referred hundreds of cases because he used to get 150, 200 cases daily in this epidemic also, because all doctors were closed their clinics. So I would like to thank Dr. Imran Topichand, because of which I got this rich experience of COVID in treating COVID. Is anybody else? China, Chini members, anybody else? Pulsatilla. And I will also like to thank my colleagues, Dr. Salman and Dr. Rangraj. Dr. Rangraj helped me in understanding the cases, and Dr. Salman worked with me day and night without bothering about his health. Actually, in between, he also got infected with mild symptoms. Okay, so the remedy prescribed is Chinina Mars. As Dr. Shivashankar said, it is a case of Chinina Mars. If you read Chini numbers, you will understand why I prescribed this. So after treatment, the choroid score became 2 from the 5 and left moderate pleural effusion with the underlying features of suggestive of chronic liver disease, which is old. But this choroid scoring 5 and that glass ground opacities, everything went away, I think in 15 or 10 days. So thank you. Any other question? If you have any other question, then please let me know. Otherwise, I will end this discussion here. Or if anybody wants anything to add, Dr. Salman, Dr. Rangraj, Dr. Imran, Dr. Vikas, so if you people want to add something. Okay, thank you all. Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Shashank, you were requested to conclude the webinar.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Ubaidullah, for a very knowledgeable session. It was a great listening from your side, and there were a number of cases which you have discussed for the management and treatment of COVID-19. And it was indeed a delighted session and a knowledgeable session for all of us. Thank you for being a part on this day with Schwabe India. And we look forward for more such interaction with you in near future, sir. So I hope all the questions have been answered by you, sir. And I guess no other questions are left for us to ask you. So thank you for that also, doctor.
Yeah, thank you.
And sir. Thank you, sir. And one more thing for the for all the attendees and all the participants here, we are also going to organize another webinar in collaboration with Karnataka Qualified Homeopathic Doctor Association, Bangalore. It is jointly presented with Dr. Wilmar Schwabe, India, on this international speakers. It would be a webinar with international speakers on the occasion of Doctors' Day. And the topic would be homeopathic management of COVID cases. And it is scheduled on 4th of July on Sunday at 3 p.m. So I request all of you to attend that also. And our team will soon share all the details for that, the flyer and everything. And it would be on a Zoom, it would be also a Zoom meeting. And we all anticipate that you all will meet there on the occasion of Doctors' Day in this webinar. So thank you everyone for being part of this interaction. Thank you again, Dr. Ubaidullah. Thank you, Dr. Valavan. Thank you, Nawaz. And again, indeed, I am highly thankful to Dr. Haldar, Dr. Suman Haldar, who organized all the things. And soon, all the participants will receive a certificate on their email IDs. So thank you everyone for being a part of this interaction. Have a good day.
And one more thing, Mr. Shashank.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
We have already shared the link for the next webinar. So all the participants are requested to see in the chat section so that if they click on the link, there will be a form. If they fill it up, they will automatically get the Zoom link.
Yes.
So all are requested to register there. And it is a mega webinar, national level mega webinar. So all are requested to join. Thank you very much. Thank you,
Dr. One more thing that please also check your spam mail. If it might be that it is jumped into your spam mail. So also always after registration, check your spam mails for the registration link.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.